Hello and welcome to Controllerstech. In this fifth video of the STM32 Ethernet series using the W5500, we will look at how to create a simple HTTP web server on an STM32 board. For the demonstration, I will build a basic web server that can control the LED connected directly to the STM32 development board. This web server will include three pages, an index page, an LED off page, and an LED on page. Each page will have buttons that allow the user to move to the other pages. Using these buttons, the user will be able to switch between the different pages easily. This video continues from part 1 of this series, where we learned how to connect the module using SPI, configure it, and finally test the connection by pinging it. Because of that, there are no new hardware connections needed for this project. Here, I am simply using the same project from part 1 of the series, and I've renamed it to part 5 for convenience. Since our goal is to create an HTTP server, the next step is to copy the required files for it. Open the Wiznet IO library that we downloaded in part 1 of this series. Go inside the Internet folder. Here, you will find a folder for the HTTP server, which already includes everything we need. Copy this folder into our project and place it inside the Ethernet folder that we created earlier for the W5500 files. This folder already contains the code to handle and parse HTTP requests, so we don't need to implement that part ourselves. Along with this, I have also prepared an example HTTP server, so let's copy those example files into the project as well. You can download these files from the project link mentioned in the article linked in the description of this video. Next, we will go through how this example server works, and how you can follow the same logic to build your own HTTP server. At the beginning of the file, we need to define how many sockets we will use for the HTTP server. As I explained in the previous videos, the W5500 has a total of 8 hardware sockets, numbered from 0 to 7. Out of these, socket 7 is already used for DHCP, and socket 6 is used for the DNS server. This means we can use the remaining 5 sockets for the HTTP server. The more sockets you assign, the more clients can connect at the same time, and the server will be able to handle multiple requests without getting overloaded. In this example, I am using 2 sockets. You also need to define which specific socket numbers you want the server to use. Next, I have defined 3 static web pages, the index page, the LED on page, and the LED off page. Each of these pages contains 2 buttons that allow you to move to the other pages. These pages will be served whenever their respective URI is requested. Once the pages are defined, they must be registered inside the setup function. We use the function register HTTP server web content to register each page for a specific URI. So whenever a client requests that URI, the respective page will automatically be served. The HTTP server setup function also initializes the server with the socket numbers that we provide. Note that the default W5500 configuration does not let us directly handle URIs ourselves. In other words, the library does not provide a built-in function that lets us perform custom actions when a client visits a specific URL. Although we could use CGI, Common Gateway Interface, for this, that method is slightly more complex than what we need right now. We will cover CGI and dynamic web page updates in the next video. For this video, I have created a custom function called HTTP Dynamic Handler to manually handle URIs. Inside this function, you can perform different actions, such as controlling the LED, based on which URI the client accesses. In this example, we will call another function, LED control, to turn the LED on or off depending on the page the user visits. However, the W5500 does not call this custom function automatically. We need to connect it into the library manually. Copy the definition of this function and open the httpserver.c file. Inside this file, find the function named httpprocesshandler. This is the function that handles incoming URIs, so it is the ideal place to insert our custom handler. Declare httpDynamicHandler as an external function here. Now look for the switch case section that handles the GET requests. After all the predefined GET requests are processed, call the httpDynamicHandler function and pass the PHTTP request structure to it. This structure contains the URI requested by the client, and it will allow our custom handler to control the LED based on the page accessed. Next, we have another function called httpServerRun. This function simply calls httpServerRun for all the sockets we assigned earlier. The httpServerRun function takes care of everything, handling connections, reading incoming requests, parsing them, serving files, and sending responses. You must call httpServerRun inside a while loop, or inside the infinite loop of a free RTOS task. The LED control function is already defined as an external function in this file, so we need to define it somewhere else. Let's define it inside the main file. This function will write a value to pin C13, where the LED is connected on the blue pill board. Since this LED is active low, resetting the pin will turn the LED on, and setting it high will turn the LED off. That means the value you write needs to be toggled based on what action you want. Now let's see how to use this example HTTP server. Include the httpServerExample.h file. Inside the main function, after the W5500 has been initialized, call the function httpServerSetup to initialize the HTTP server. Inside the while loop, call the function httpServerRun so the STM32 can continuously run the web server. If you are using free RTOS, you can place this function inside the infinite loop of a separate task. That is all we need to set up, so let's build the project now. There are a few warnings, but no errors, so we can go ahead and flash the project to the board. Open the serial console to view the logs from the STM32. As the logs show, after getting an IP address from DHCP, the HTTP server starts running on both sockets. We assigned two hardware sockets, 0 and 1, for the HTTP server, so the server is active on both of them. The IP address of the server is the same as the module's IP, which is 192.168.1.4. Let's open a browser and enter this IP address. Here, the index page has loaded successfully. If you check the logs, you will see the client's IP address and port from where the page was requested. It also shows that the requested URI was index.html, and the server served it correctly. Now let's click the button to turn the LED on. You can see the LED turns on, and the server loads the LED on page. The logs will show more details every time a new page is requested by the client. Let's turn the LED off. A new page is served by the web server, and the LED switches off. As I mentioned earlier, I created three pages, the index page, the LED on page, and the LED off page, and we have now tested all three. The LED responds smoothly to the button clicks, and the web server serves the correct page each time. So our HTTP web server is working properly on the STM32. We were able to control the LED using any device connected to the same network as the W5500. The three pages we created in this tutorial were all static pages. In the next video, we will see how to use CGI, Common Gateway Interface, to serve dynamic web pages. This will make communication between the STM32 and the web server easier and more flexible. That is it for this video. You can download the full project from the article linked in the description. Feel free to leave a comment if you have any doubts. Keep watching, and have a great day ahead.